Thank you for joining. This is the Women of World War I. My name is Barbara Varanka. I'm a board member of the Young Friends of the Kansas City Public Library, and I'm just thrilled to be here on what is a very busy, I'm sure for you, an important and historic day, talking to Stacie Petersen about the women of World War I. So we'll go ahead and get started. So this is a collaboration between the Young Friends of the Kansas City Public Library and the Modernists, who are the Young Friends of the National World War I Museum and Memorial. We've been doing a couple collaborations together, and it's just been so much fun. Two really vibrant groups coming together and planning this event was a really great time. So we're both, you know, dedicated to promoting these great institutions in Kansas City. We'd love for you to follow us and learn about future events. So you can find our handles here, or if you'd like to join us as members, you can learn about each organization at our websites. Just pulling up my document real quick. Having a little technical difficulty, of course. I'm just gonna try a different way. So as I talk with Stacie, we'd love for you to add questions. There's a Q&A section of Zoom. Feel free to add questions there as we go, and then we'll take questions at the very end. So just a little bit about Women Crush Wednesdays. It's a series that we started with the Young Friends, and we really try to highlight local women who are doing amazing things. Our series was previously live, but we've transitioned it to be on Zoom during these unprecedented times. So I'm thrilled to be moderating tonight and speaking with the National World War I Museum and Memorial Exhibitions Manager and Registrar, Stacie Petersen. And I'd love to tell you a little bit about Stacie. Stacie Petersen is the Exhibitions Manager and Registrar at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. The Museum and Memorial began collecting artifacts in 1920 and holds the most comprehensive collection of Great War artifacts in the world. Under Petersen's guidance, the Museum and Memorial has begun to digitize and provide resources online with over 40,000 object records currently available. That's amazing. These records have been accessed over 1.5 million times in nearly 170 countries. So with that, I'd love to introduce Stacie.
All right, hello everyone. Thank you so much for having me here this evening. I am actually coming to you from my desk here located inside collection storage. So a very unique opportunity because there are literally five doors I have to unlock every morning when I come to work.
Yeah, thank you for doing that, for being there. It really sets the scene for us, right?
Yes, it does.
So thank you, Stacie, for doing this and taking time out of your evening.
Of course.
So my first question is sort of a broad one, but I wanted to start with, how did women play a role in World War I?
Oh, and that is definitely a very broad question, and one that we will have to touch on the very upper levels of this evening. If we were going to do a deep dive on every single role that women played during World War I, we'd probably be here for the rest of the night. Everyone, you know, gather for a giant slumber party for the entire country. But we're going to start with looking at that viewpoint of one of the first really traditional roles that you see of women. You have the role of not only sweethearts, but also that role of mother. And a lot of that imagery you see play out within the sheet music of the time, which is those two images here that I'm showcasing now. Again, I would love to be able to sit here and sing and talk about the lyrics within these, because they are fantastic and cringeworthy on so many different levels. But you see this not only in the United States, but you can also look abroad and look at different romance cards that were distributed like in France and other countries. But also just the role of mother and sweetheart in terms of correspondence of those soldiers writing home from the war. We have some fantastic letters within the museum's collection. A lot of those letters we've been working on getting transcribed over the last year as we had the shift from the normal world into pandemic world. We were able to shift a lot of our staff into transcription to assist with that during our closure. And within those letters, we found some great stories. There's one gentleman that definitely had a very close relationship with his mother, to the point where there's probably about 4 or 5 pages of letters that he was writing to her about his constipation issues and maybe different advice that she could provide in terms of that situation. But also, we do have a lot of other parameters as well. And that is looking at women on the home front. So transitioning from like a domestic life into the factories themselves. So for example, within 1914, in the German armaments producer Krupp, my immense apologies to anyone that does speak German, French, any of those foreign languages, I will butcher more than likely every single pronunciation. But that particular company in 1914 in Germany employed almost no women at all. But then by 1917, women made up nearly 30% of that company's 175,000 workers. And across the entire nation of Germany, you're looking at a total of nearly 1.4 million German women were employed within that war labor force. You can also look at the women within Great Britain. They also stepped up in terms of arms production. And within that, they expanded the employment of women. In July of 1914, 3.3 million women worked in paid employment in Britain. And then by July of 1917, that number has increased to 4.7 million women. Here within the United States, and of course my slideshow did not advance, I was supposed to.
I think it's the evening of technical difficulties, but hopefully
nothing major. Right? You have women working here in the United States making food production for those soldiers. So for example, here within this factory in Chicago, the armor factory, we have women peeling what appears to be a quantity of onions for the production of beef hash that will then get canned in giant tins that will be sent overseas for the soldiers to be able to eat. But we also are looking at women in those more traditional roles that were contributing to the war effort. They didn't just have to be working within factories. So every housewife in the United States was actually asked to sign a pledge card stating that she would carry out the directions and advice of the Food Administration in the conduct of her household insofar as her circumstances could permit. So this can mean a plethora of things. So you're looking at canning food for future use. You're looking at growing vegetables in the backyard and limiting consumption of meat, wheat, and fats. So you're looking at those Wheatless Wednesdays, different food circumstances there. So almost you could say the beginning of a gluten-free diet. But really also, as we talked about in that first slide that I was showing, women were really expected to kind of bolster the morale of their families at home and those loved ones overseas. Now, also, the other situation that we're looking at is in terms of nurses. So those nurses could be those women that were serving in the U.S. Army Nurse Corps, as well as the Navy Nurse Corps. And it's one of those really situations where the American Expeditionary Forces, so those were actually the fighting men that were going to be trained and sent overseas, while they were still preparing to go overseas, the U.S. Army nurses were actually sent ahead and being assigned to British hospitals in order to kind of start their training and start learning the process there. And so you're looking at, by June of 1918, there were more than 3,000 American nurses in over 750 British-run hospitals in France. But then you also have this other side of things where you have those nurses at the front, but women physicians were really facing obstacles. And they really couldn't put their skills to the use that they wanted. So those women were actually rejected from the U.S. Army Medical Corps, but that did not stop them. If they were going to find a way to serve no matter what. So those female physicians, they kind of went into the war effort as civilian contract surgeons with the Red Cross or other humanitarian relief organizations, or even served with the French Army. The Medical Women's National Association, for example, they raised money to send their own doctors overseas to work in hospitals run by the American Red Cross, which then would be in more of a volunteer basis. And so you're looking at, by the end of the war, nearly 80 women doctors from this organization were at work in the devastated regions of Europe, caring for civilians and soldiers and treating diseases such as influenza and typhoid. But you're also looking at, it's the automobile age. Everyone driving cars, becoming drivers, and motorized ambulances were a key to medical treatment on that battlefield. So many women who actually knew how to drive, they would volunteer to go overseas to serve as ambulance and truck drivers or even mechanics. They delivered those medical supplies, transported patients to hospitals, and drove through artillery fire to retrieve wounded. One of the other areas that women were able to serve is within the Navy as a yeomaness. And here's a woman, yeomaness, serving in the Navy. One of the interesting things with women yeomaness was that the Navy was shorthanded at the beginning of World War I. But fortunately for them, there was very vague wording in a section of the Naval Act of 1916 outlining who could serve, which created a loophole where women were able to join the ranks as a yeoman, non-commissioned officer, and around 12,000 women enlisted in the Navy under the title of a yeoman F. So for female. Most women yeomen served stateside on naval bases, replacing those men who had deployed to Europe. While many female recruits, they performed clerical duties, such as this woman here, but some also worked as truck drivers, mechanics, radio operators, telephone operators, translators, camouflage artists, and munition workers. But the interesting thing is that they had the same responsibilities as their male counterparts and received the same pay of $28.75 a month. Now, American women weren't the only ones to serve within the military. You're also looking at British women. They served in uniform as well in the Royal Navy and Royal Air Force. In fact, the last known surviving veteran of World War I was Florence Green of the Royal Air Force, who passed away in 2012, just 2 weeks shy of her 111th birthday. Now, another segment of women that served are the female single corps telephone operators. Some of you may know them more by the title of Hello Girl. So they would serve at the front. And we're really, they're tasked with improving those communications on the Western Front between the Allied forces. Now, General John J. Pershing of the U.S. Army called for the creation of the Single Corps Female Telephone Operators Unit. And this unit recruited women who were bilingual in French and English to serve as those telephone switchboard operators on the Western Front. So the women, they receive physical training, observe strict military protocol, wore identity discs, and worked very close to those front lines. Now, the female recruits were nicknamed the Hello Girls, which a term some of them felt very were disparaging of their efforts. So that's why I typically try to prefer the calling them by their proper name of the Signal Corps Female Telephone Operators Unit. Now, they really became known for their bravery and focus under pressure. But when they returned to the United States after the end of the war, the Hello Girls did not receive veteran status or benefits. It wasn't until 1977 when President Jimmy Carter signed legislation that those few surviving women telephone operators were able to actually receive recognition of their veteran status.
Wow.
Now, one of the last groups that we have to be able to talk about are actual female combat soldiers. Now, in the United States, France, Great Britain, you did not see those female soldiers. But within the countries of Russia, Bulgaria, Romania, and Serbia, women did serve as combat troops. And actually, Queen Marie of Romania, who was here in Kansas City in 1926 at the site dedication, or for the opening of the museum, Liberty Memorial at that time, she was actually a combat woman at served for Romania as princess at that time. Ironically, I found out today a little bit of side note information is that she was one of the few individuals who actually invoiced the Liberty Memorial Association for all of her costs associated with the stay here in Kansas City. So we have copies of those bills within our archives.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah, so as you can see, they really served in every single capacity possible.
Absolutely. I think that's incredible. I had no idea how wide it spanned. I was curious if you could talk a little bit about some of the maybe well-known names or, you know, more influential, more famous women of World War I and what we know about them.
Yeah, of course. There's a lot of names that can be talked about, but I did select about three names that I wanted to at least mention this evening. One of the first women that we want to mention tonight is actually Marie Curie. So that's a name that many of us are probably well associated with. And what Curie actually did during World War I, going back to that concept of women drivers and driving those ambulances, she actually provided her own private vehicle and invented a mobile X-ray unit, which were kind of called their radiological cars that were nicknamed Little Curies. And she ultimately trained 150 women to be X-ray operators on the battlefront. And Marie actually served as one herself. And which, as those that are familiar with Marie's story, more than likely probably led to her actual death from radiation exposure. But at the same time, she was able to probably save thousands of men's lives with that concept of X-ray.
Wow, that's incredible.
The other woman I want to touch on was Edith Cavell. So Edith has more of a sorrowful story. She was a British nurse who actually operated a medical clinic and nursing school in Brussels at the start of the war in August of 1914. And when war broke out, she chose to stay in her adopted homeland when the Germans invaded, and she would provide medical treatment for injured soldiers regardless of their nationality. But she would also smuggle injured soldiers and civilians out of Belgium to neutral Holland, which led to Cavell being arrested by German occupation authorities in August 1915. Now, she admitted to having helped those servicemen escape and that some had even contacted her to say they had safely arrived in England. Cavell was not sentenced to death, not for aiding the escape of enemy servicemen, but actually because the men had been able to return to a country at war with Germany. Hmm. So she spent 8 weeks in a prison, and despite protests from both the United States and Spain, she was executed by a German firing squad at the Belgian National Shooting Range at dawn on October 12, 1915. So her execution was really condemned by the full international community, and she really became a martyr of World War I. And then we have Grace Banker. Grace Banker was actually the chief operator of the U.S. Signal Corps Women Telephone Operators. So she led that group of women that were recruited and sent overseas. And she actually led a group of the original 33 women to help connect those calls. And as I said, they had to all be fluent in French because a lot of the local women operators in France already were not bilingual. Mm-hmm. And actually, with her telephone unit number one, Grace was operating switchboards while under artillery bombardment and being bombed by German planes during the San Miguel and Meuse-Argonne offensives. And after the war, Banker was given a Distinguished Service Medal. And if you're ever able to visit the museum here in Kansas City, you're actually able to see Grace's uniform and helmet that's currently on exhibit that was donated to us by her family along with other personal belongings.
Wow, incredible.
So I just three women that touch a little bit on those stories.
Absolutely. I know that when we were kind of preparing for this and talking about this event, one name that kept coming up a lot was Alta Mae Andrews.
Yeah.
And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about her and why she's so influential and why that name kept kind of coming up as like the woman of World War I.
Well, let me see if I can share a fabulous photo of Miss Alta Mae. This is Miss Alta Mae Andrews. So she spent 2 years serving with the Army Nurse Corps at the American Red Cross Hospital number one, just outside Paris in the western suburb of Paris. She was, as her passport tells us, she was 27 years old with blue eyes, auburn hair, standing at a strong 5 foot, 5.5 inches high. Now, what makes Alta Mae one of our favorites around here was not really due to the heroics that she did, or things like that. It is because, as I reach over here and because my desk is inside collection storage, we have a 400-page memoir that she wrote, comprised of all of her letters. And before anyone panics and sees that I was not wearing white gloves, it's all right, my hands are clean. We're handling paper materials such as that bound volume. You prefer not to have white gloves on because you don't want to accidentally tear pages by catching them. But Alta Mae is fantastic. Like I said, we have 400 pages of letters that she was writing home to her family, to her sister. And Alta Mae loved being a nurse. It's all she wanted to do. Apparently her father was a Civil War veteran and would always talk about a nurse that he had been rescued by, saved, had a friendly relationship with Mrs. Briggs. And all Alta Mae ever wanted to do in life was basically to become Mrs. Briggs. Hmm. So in those initial letters that she has in that volume talking about her arrival at Camp Custer for the beginning of her service, she was so excited that she didn't realize that she was supposed to wait till the next day. So instead she hopped on a train where she was the only woman, arrived at camp like at midnight, luckily had made friends with an officer. So he escorted her like the 5 miles across camp to the nurse's home cabins where they were staying. And luckily there was at least one nurse awake because all the doors were barred. But ultimately he's like, I'm just here, I'm happy. So that's what makes her so special to us, is just the volume of quotes and information that we can pull about life as a World War I nurse, especially in the Army Nurse Corps. So what I did tonight was I went through the book, trying not to fall too down, just sit and read and read and read, because again, her writing is amazing. But I pulled some quotes so that way we can kind of see the whole spasm of emotions that Alta Mae can bring to us. So the first couple two that I want to talk about or read are about her nurses. It is that sorrow. It is those emotions that we are so associated with World War I. So the first comes from July 19th, 1918. Last night was the first night that I've had many seriously wounded Americans under my care. Rogers in bed 63 was a fine American lad of 18. Upon appearing for duty at 7, the day nurses reported his condition as critical, advising me to watch him closely. Shortly after midnight, I found his pulse almost imperceptible. Parting the blue gingham shield, I raised the lantern and saw that death was but a matter of a few moments. Without opening his eyes, but sensing my hand on his, he smiled as he softly whispered, "Oh, mother, is it you? I knew you'd come. You did get here, didn't you, mother? Talk to me." I stood there hurting all over inside, and in another minute or two, he was gone. The day before, on July 18th of 1918, she wrote, "The night of the 16th, we began to witness the result of the desperate fighting which had stopped, for a while at least, the determined German drive toward Paris. Our hospital alone received over 500 American wounded. One can work until one becomes dog-tired and weary, but there follows a marvelous sense of satisfaction which can never be obtained from washing beds." So she gives us those emotions, the sorrow that comes with war and the caring for all these young men, because American hospital, this hospital she was at was the evacuation hospital. But also throughout her memoirs, she also gives us other snippets into their lives at the Army Nurse Corps. So this little tidbit that she writes about, "Whenever we managed to get into Paris, we thoroughly enjoyed window shopping. The Rue de la Paix holds a strange fascination for everyone. When we gaze longingly at the displays of gorgeous clothes and dainty lingerie, the cobweb hose and the tiny spike-heeled slippers, we say, 'C'est la guerre,' and plod along in our heavy cowards." So it gives us that insight into the private life, that they weren't always working.
Yeah, she's such a great writer too. I mean,
she is. She really is. Like I said, she was hoping to actually publish this book. So unfortunately, I don't believe it ever became a published item, except the bound volume that we are so fortunate to have here as well. But she also talks about the love of the soldiers and their cigarettes. So apparently she talks about, you know, realizing how great a charm these slender cylinders possessed for these poor boys. She apparently harassed every YMCA man, Knights of Columbus, Salvation Army, Red Cross, or even a Jewish welfare worker who enters her ward at night for a package of cigarettes, because her pockets and their spacious skirts of our uniforms are adequate to hold quite a few of them for emergency purposes. So basically she wanted to make sure she was prepared for no matter what the young men were requesting.
Absolutely. I was curious if you could talk a little bit about how the museum came about her collection. Was it donated by her family, or how did that come to be?
Yeah, fortunately this collection was donated by her family. Over 95% of our collection is actually donated to us. And for most of those donations come from family members. Every once in a while, we get donations from individuals who found the collection stored in their attic. Maybe it was stored, you know, in their, we had one collection come to us that was stored in someone's outer building, like a corn crib out on their farm. So part of that collection meant we had to deal with a slight mouse nest that had been nested in it, and the cleanup that came from that. You never know how things will arrive to you, but fortunately, Ulta May's collection came to us from her family, comprised of, like I said, the memoir, the letters is the gem of that entire collection. But like I said, her letters really just show the gamut of the war, those feelings that you get from the actual nursing care, as well as just their experiences. Because World War I was this huge battle, this huge, horrible war. But yet at the same time, most of the individuals over there are, you know, teens to 20-year-olds. And this is their first time, you know, abroad, first time away. And whether they were women or men, they wanted to experience it all. So you have the goriness of war, but also this experience of going out to Paris and looking, you know, window shopping for souvenirs, because she also talks about, you know, the souvenirs that she's buying to send home to her family.
Wow.
And what makes her special for us is we have several women collections in the museum, but none that we currently hold have that much depth in terms of letters. We have a smattering of letters, but again, having this 400 page volume of all this description is just wonderful, because you might have copy, you might have their uniforms, you have, you know, those three-dimensional things that you think of when you think of coming to a museum, but it's these letters that give those objects those stories. Absolutely. And allow us to really tell the full story and brings those things to life.
For sure. Yeah, I think the little kind of snippets that you chose really highlight who she was, and, you know, some of those anecdotes about her really paint a picture. For you personally, is there like some, what's your favorite thing about Alta Mae? What do you kind of personally love about her?
The amount of emotion that she writes with, because some letters are basic information, they read just straight and steady, but others are joys because they actually have a voice. Mm-hmm. When you're reading those letters, you can hear the person, or you can at least imagine what the person sounds like when you're reading them. Or like that photograph I shared with you all, where she's just, you know, has the tip of her hat in her fingertip. It just makes you imagine this personality. And then when you read those letters that have that much personality, that much emotion within them, it just adds that extra layer of delight.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's so great. I'm glad you chose those passages to highlight her. Just kind of switching gears a little bit, what is something that people may not know, or something surprising about women's impact on World War I? I think your introductory kind of span of all the different roles they had surprised me a lot. I didn't know a lot of those things, but is there something else that is surprising, or that people kind of are shocked about that, you know, relates to women's involvement in World War I?
Probably one of the biggest outcomes for women's involvement in World War I was kind of the extra propulsion for the women's suffrage movement. Because during World War I, you had that transition of women moving from more the domestic sphere of just home life, working within the home, to showing their skill set, that they were able to go out and work in factories, or able to fill in those roles of men. Because, for example, by the time the U.S. actually entered World War I in 1917, 15 states had actually already passed full women's suffrage. And in fact, Montana had already elected a woman, Jeanette Rankin, to the House of Representatives, which was kind of odd, you could say, because you have, that's basically highlighting that women could run for national office, but cannot actually vote in national elections. Crazy. And then as World War I progressed and continued, you have Alice Paul and her National Women's Party continuing to protest peacefully outside the White House. Again, going back to that concept of we can serve, you vote for us to be able to go overseas. Now we're looking for that vote. Now it's actually the election of 1918, which then ushered in new members of Congress that were a little bit friendlier to really pass that 19th Amendment. And going through the process, it became law on August 26, 1920. And it's also, when you look at the story of women's suffrage as a whole, it's those countries that were involved in World War I that really were the first countries to have women have the right to vote.
That's fascinating. I never really made the connection between the two, but there's a lot of overlap there.
Yeah. And for those of you that are here in Kansas City, or able to eventually get to Kansas City, here in the coming year or so, we actually currently have an exhibit up in our West Gallery space called Votes and Voices. So we opened that in August for that passing of women's right to vote.
Awesome. Great. And I'm, you know, also today has been a historic day for women in politics as well. So kind of.
Exactly, become full circle.
Yeah, exactly. I think you've done a fantastic job of highlighting the collection and some of the different women involved in it. Kind of overall, could you talk a little bit about the artifacts in the collection that do highlight women, and maybe which ones are your favorite? I know Ultime sounds like a favorite already, but any other favorites?
Yeah, so within the collection, we have a whole gamut of different objects that we can utilize. A few of my favorites in terms of that, there's two pieces that I'm going to share with you all this evening. And the first being this lovely autograph book. So this is coming from a nurse. Her name is Florence Hempel, and she is from Kansas. But we do have several of these little autograph books within the collection. And they're just great because when you think of an autograph book, you typically think of just someone signing their name. But a lot of these books have lovely poems and other messages. Mm-hmm. But then you have like the illustrations that you see here on the right that are just these little gems.
That's fantastic.
That just show this gentleman with his thermometer. So a lot of these little autograph books were completed and done by those soldiers that were in their care. Mm-hmm. And then we have on exhibit, we have a collection of women's uniforms. One of my favorite uniforms is this one from a female physician because she's wearing pants, which is just wonderful because it's that transition from the partial uniform you can see here on the left with the skirt to pants. So those are kind of my two of my favorite items. I really feel like almost every day, depending upon what I'm working on or what has come into the collection, it can change so rapidly.
Sure, absolutely. I'm sure you come across little gems all the time, right?
Little gems all the time, and it might just be one little snippet within something.
Yeah. Yeah, that illustration was fantastic. It's still so vivid, even though it's, you know, probably over 100 years old.
Yes.
Right. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you got interested in museum science and kind of what that means to study museum science and that field.
Yeah. So that goes back to, I have, for those that are curious, how I ended up, you know, I have a desk in the corner of a collection storage room. I have a bachelor's degree in history and classical studies, but then I have a master's degree in museum science. That particular program was through Texas Tech University. Other programs go by different names, such as museum studies. Mm-hmm. But my particular graduate program really looked at how to care for a museum collection. That was kind of my focus. So the temperature, the humidity, how to handle objects, how to store them, how to make them accessible to the public, how to do exhibitions. So kind of a lot of that behind the scenes work that gets everything together and makes it accessible to the entire world. Mm-hmm. So one of my, some of my job duties are, it's a menagerie thing. So as Barbara mentioned in the introduction, that one of my duties is overseeing the digitization of the collection, but also as registrar, I am responsible for the legality of the collection. So all the documents transferring the ownership of the collection from the donor into the museum collection itself. So we're looking at also rights and reproduction. So if someone needs an image for a movie or a book, I'm the one who will handle that paperwork in order to process that.
Oh, wow.
Also any customs. So we're importing objects from another country, all the customs that has to be able to go through to get it out of that country or into this country. Courier jobs. So if something, again, going back to that concept of coming from a foreign country, I've had to go to Paris and pick up a collection and fly it back into the country. But that also meant, I know, I was solely responsible for this collection until I made it back here at the museum. So for that entire travel time, if something happened, it was me. Wow. So really my background in museum science goes back to how to care for the collections and how to protect them, preserve them, but also make sure we all keep those legal issues above board.
Wow, that's fascinating. I didn't even think about the legal aspect of it, but that's I'm sure a very important part of it.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely. I don't think we mentioned this in your bio, but could you talk about how long you've been with the museum and also what your favorite thing about working at the museum is?
Yeah. So I started in January 2012. So I am just past my anniversary date. So that's been, what, nine years I've been here?
Wow.
Originally from Iowa, and then my job prior to moving here was in Roswell, New Mexico. Mm. So not working with UFOs or aliens, but working at the City History Science Museum and Art Museum there.
Nice.
But really one of my favorite things here at the museum to work with as part of my job, and this actually I could probably talk about for the next 3 hours if we had the time, is that digitization concept. Digitizing the collection, making it accessible, keyword searchable, and then putting that collection online, because it's taking that collection, our collection, and opening it up not just to museum staff to be able to utilize more for educational purposes, you know, for exhibition purposes, for graphic design, for things like that, but actually taking our collection and opening it to anyone that's able to access an internet connection anywhere in the entire world. And awesome. I know our collection is utilized in a lot of school districts as a primary resource for students to be able to work with. I've received emails from family members of servicemen and women who had no idea that they anything in our collection related back to their loved one. Or people have emailed me excited because, you know, they had never seen a photograph of their grandfather, but we had it here. And because we had digitized it, put it online, they learned about us, accessed it, and was able to see them for the very first time ever. And it's those experiences, knowing that I'm opening this treasure trove of information, because we have online about 43,000 records as of this call today. But overall, we probably have over 300,000 objects in the collection.
Oh, wow.
So being able to open it to the world is just wonderful. And be able, again, like just that, and seeing what people can do and learn and study and open it further to researchers, be able to unlock those little nuggets that we might not know because we're not specialists in like some sort of minute study area of World War I, but also opening it so people can learn that World War I is not just about military battles and military strategy. There are so many other layers within it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think even during this call, you've kind of opened up my view on World War I and how many areas it impacted.
Mm-hmm.
I think the digitization piece is fascinating. I was wondering if you could talk about how people who are tuning in can access the archives online, and also maybe if there's a particular resource that you think is really great that, you know, that you want people to know about, if you could also touch on that.
Yeah, so we invite everyone to come to our website, which is theworldwar.org. And within that website, you can actually access our database, which lives on an external platform, but the link will take you over to that platform to be able to explore. Now we are in process of migrating to a whole new platform. So if you go experience the online collections database this evening and want to come back in 3 or 4 months, hopefully by then it will look entirely different. Okay. Which if we are successful in sending that over, and it looks like it was, the link there was dropped in the chat. So if anyone needs to have a go down that rabbit hole, feel free. But also on that site, you can see a lot of components from our collection. So there are great resources on there. So articles about women in World War I, a little deeper dive than what we were able to go into tonight, for the educators in the room or people that know educators. We have a fantastic trove of educational lesson plans. There's an educational newsletter you can sign up for. Those that might be working from home with your students at home with you, there's different resources that you can throw at your children there. There's also a whole gamut of online exhibitions that I invite you to come out and explore. And a lot of that comes out of our digitization program. One of our favorites and most, and it's been up for several years, but it's a very successful one. It looks at warfare. So looking at food during World War I. There are also some great recipe books on that exhibition that we've also modernized a few of the recipes. So we don't speak 1917 recipe language. We've modernized those as well. But from our website, I invite you to the go over to our YouTube page. All of our lectures are archived over there from the past several years. And if you search within there for women, you'll find a lot more lectures that can go in a lot more depth than we were able to cover this evening on there as well.
Awesome. Yeah, I think your organization does such a fantastic job of just making all of these resources available, especially right now when it's a little bit tougher for people to actually visit the museum in person, but it's, you know, there's so many online resources. So thank you for highlighting those.
Of course.
So I have a couple speed round questions.
All right.
And then I see we have quite a few questions in the Q&A.
Okay.
So I'll jump to those after this. So, you know, it's a little bit sad during pandemic times to ask this, but favorite place in Kansas City?
Elmwood Cemetery. I love cemeteries. We'll always go out and travel there. Elmwood is the second oldest cemetery here in Kansas City, but the oldest integrated cemetery. And it's just a very peaceful location to go out and go for a lovely walk. You can also see the markings on the pavement from some 5Ks that have been running in the past. So if anyone needs a good, safe place here in Kansas City to go run without car traffic, we invite you out to Elmwood.
Wow, that's great. And it's very safe to go there. You can be socially distanced.
Exactly. It's easy to be socially distanced.
What about a book you'd recommend?
I am a huge fan of fantasy, and one of my long-running series that I love is The Chronicles of Elantra by Michelle Segarra.
Okay, cool. I'll have to check that out. You may not be eating out very much right now, but favorite dish or drink at a Kansas City restaurant or bar?
It's hard to settle on one particular food or drink, but really anything that is served up or brewed up by City Barrel. Mm. For those local Kansas Cityans or those that's coming to visit, it's in the East Crossroads. Okay. And if you are a fan of sour beers, they are fantastic. And they have everything to go. So you can order food and your drinks, and it's all packaged there ready for you.
Perfect. Awesome. What about the first thing you want to do when the pandemic is over?
Oh gosh. Hang out with friends inside. That does not involve a patio heater that we bought off Amazon.
Yes. That sounds wonderful. And last speed round question, who is your woman crush? It could be anyone from the history or the present times.
Yeah. It's actually someone from World War I. Her name was Ruth Law, and she actually had one of the longest and most colorful careers of early female aviators.
Oh, wow.
And she was so successful that in 1917, she was one of the first people to be allowed to wear a military uniform, not allowed in combat. So instead, she did different flyovers, exhibitions, for Liberty Loans, fundraisers, Red Cross, and got paid about $9,000 a week. And after the war, she had a three-plane troop, and they would fly through fireworks, race cars, do a whole bunch of other stuff. Unfortunately, she had to retire in 1922 when she read an article about herself in the newspaper that her husband had published announcing her retirement.
Oh, no.
She was scared of how many daredevil tasks that she had done.
Okay. I guess that's a way to retire, but
it's a way to retire, but she had a very lovely career up to that point.
Wonderful. That's so cool. I'm going to look her up.
Yeah, that's why I did not know anything about her until we happened to get a donation a couple years ago of one of her little flyers that had been thrown out of the plane.
Wow. It's incredible. Awesome. Well, we have quite a few questions. So one from Carla, were there protests against the way the Hello Girls were treated as non-veterans upon returning home?
That I do not know, actually. I do know we have on our YouTube channel a lecture that was given about those female Civil Corps telephone operators. So there may be more information within that lecture itself about that particular aspect.
Okay, got it. Another important question from Sharon. Are the pant legs laced?
Laced as in, they are definitely laced up the legs. I do not recall, I have not actually dressed or undressed that particular mannequin, so I do not know how it is at the waist, how it is done.
We'll have to go investigate in person. This is also something I was curious about from Doris. She asks, will Altame's letters be available for the public to read, or are they already available?
They are already available, and I believe someone, we posted in the chat there a link to her search, but you can also go to theworldwar.org and go to the collection, online collections database, and do a search for Alta May. I would recommend putting her name in quotes because that kind of helps narrow the focus. Okay. For those that had to do web searches in the 90s, go back to those Boolean search structures, and that will help narrow that search down. And if you have difficulty finding it, and were able to have issues locating it, feel free to go ahead and email me from that database as well. Now, how to spell her name is Alta, A-L-T-A, with May being spelled M-A-E.
Alta May with an E.
Yep, you can also look up using, here's museum language, her accession number. So that is the part of her social security number for her collection here at the museum. You could say, look up 2013.13 and you'll be able to see everything that we have from her belonging there.
Awesome, great. Question from Carla. Have you ever had any phony or maybe non-authentic artifacts donated to the collection, or when you have that, how do you deal with that?
Yeah, we have had in the past, but for the most part, everything is authentic. So things that may come in that aren't, we recently had within the past year, some beer signs that were donated. They all appear to look like they were World War I period, but how you can tell that they are period made is if you hold the stein up to the light and look into it, you can see the hologram at the bottom of someone's, you can see an image at the bottom of the hologram. And one of the beer signs that were donated was not, had no hologram. So it looks like it's period, but it was definitely a reproduction. So we bring those into the collection as what we refer to as non-accessioned. We'll utilize those as an educational piece when we talk about how to spot a replica.
Interesting. Well, that's fascinating. Wow, I never would have guessed. I think we did answer Shannon's question, kind of a similar question about if Alta May's memoir has been digitized. So we talked a little bit about that. So question from the chat, as ladies working in a field that is predominantly viewed as a male-oriented pastime, military history, what has been your personal experience with breaking through gender barriers in such a male-dominated field?
Really, for the most part, I've been fortunate here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial that my gender has not been an issue, as in I am respected for my knowledge and my training that I've received and have been able to bring to the board. So I've been very fortunate in that regard.
Awesome. So you haven't felt like it's been an issue?
For me personally, no, it has not.
And then just a comment from Sharon saying that the pant leg design on that uniform is really interesting and unique for a time when wearing pants wasn't common.
Yeah, it's more, if you would compare it to male uniforms, it's they're kind of more of a jocker style. So they're very similar to male uniform pants, where it has that wider, wider area around the hip area.
I feel like I would wear them today.
That's what, I mean, they'd be great with a pair of like really high boots because they're nice and slim there to be able to slide right in.
Well, Stacie, I think that's all of our questions that I went through, and thank you so much for taking the time to, you know, prepare for this and give us some great vivid examples. And I'm so excited to dive into the collection, and thank you for highlighting those resources. So really appreciate your time. Again, thank you everyone for being here, especially on a very busy day. But thank you again, and we'll see you soon. And remember to follow Young Friends of the Library and also the Modernists to learn about upcoming events. So thanks again, Stacie.
Appreciate it. Yeah, thank you. And thank you to everyone that was able to attend this evening.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Well, we have a recording, so we'll be posting that as well for anyone who wants to rewatch or share it out. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good.